Okay, now I have been sent a link on my email address. So I will open my email to verify. So this is the link that has been sent to me, and I will have to verify my email. Maybe many of you would get the email as spam. So please check your spam if you have got the email there. Okay. So I will log in using my email. Okay, see, after logging in, you will go to tutorials, and over there you will get a drop down for files. Just click on files, and here you go. These are the Python notes. You can view it on the website itself, on our application. It will take some time, or you can also download it. See, it will start downloading, so you can download it. I think there's some issue right now because you have uploaded the file now only, so I think there is some issue. Okay, now it will start download. Yeah, so you can download it from here. Just click on the download button, it will download. Okay, so from here you can download the PDF for the Python. Now let's start today's class. Amit?
Yeah, Vishu.
Yeah.
Can you share your screen with the PPT? That's all right. Okay, that's the PPT. Is this PDF?
This is the PDF that we have uploaded. No.
I think everything is over here. You will see the whole things, the examples and other things. With the particular examples, we have defined the data, the output also. Okay. So for the today's agenda, we'll start a topic.
Conditional statements.
So we have done with that whole things, and right now we are in the conditional statement. That's great. You should copy the code for one MS Word also and copy the code. Let's see the file first. We can go to the side of the text.
Just give me a minute. Is it fine, Amit?
Yeah. That's good. Keshav, can you open the PDF? Yes, start the if else statement, copy the code, make it run the code. Okay, one question I think arises from rising and rising. So, thank you, sir. So, when you are dealing with some condition and the situations, you will deal with the yes and no information. Like, for example, if I have 50 rupees and I'm divided, I want to divide it 50 rupees according to the age. Like, if my son is like 15 year old, so I will give it 20 rupees to him. If my daughter is above than that, then I will provide 50 rupees to her. So according to that, in the whole total condition, there is one the flow chart. In the flow chart, we have a tax expression, which I have told you. According to the conditions, where we'll check the flow of data, and if the condition is false, it show you output, and if condition is true, also it also show you output. So according to that, we have four types of if else statements. Like first, we have if. We have nested if. Second is that we have if else. We have nested if else. And yeah, most and probable thing. Normal if state. The latter if the other thing. So can you show the yeah? Just can you paste it out? Then I will. Yeah. Over here we have initialized I is equal to 10. Okay. And after initializing I is equal to 10. We have introduced that if conditions, whether if the condition is true, then this thing is print out, like 10 is lesser than 15. But when the condition is false, it will not show you anything. So this type of situation is come under a normal yes or true condition. So when we want only a positive side, at the same time we use normal if statement. Let's take this example in the main code and run the code, and after it we'll see you how the condition is. Okay, right now yeah, this is one thing more. When you are dealing with the functions if and for loop and other things, yeah, remember that you will give us two space to come the whole thing, the body. Okay, as Keshav is declaring that, if Keshav, can you remove the space? Yeah. If you guys will follow the same step for the if else and for loop, so at the same time they are thinking that if condition have their body, but we have provided the such type of things which they want will be provide to the output, so it will show you error, because if statement said that indentation error. Okay, indentation error, what the indentation means, that they have some little bit different and structure which is followed by the Python codes. Okay. And this basically used in when you're dealing with the inbuilt functions, like if, for, because they have some body. Because if we are running the code, let us say if we are running the code right now, this means that the whole body is coming under the if condition. After the running of that condition, it will print this one. If you didn't give the space, that means they are globally. They are not coming under that condition. They directly run without the condition also. But if you want to check this the particular thing in this normal conditions, so you will be doing the indentation. What that means in the normals, like in other languages, we have a different brackets. We are using curly brackets. Keshav, can you write over here curly brackets? Okay. So in this one, in the other languages, we are using the condition and then use the curly brackets. Curly braces, that means the body is starting from here and it will end up over there. So in this, if you write something in this body, that means after checking the condition, it will show you the output when this condition is true. The statement is running when the condition of if is true. So over here, the indentation also is giving the same thing. Like if I is equal is smaller than 15, that time you want to print this one. So you will be passing the whole data which you want to print in the body of that if statement by giving the two space, like with the same statement line, giving the two space. Okay. So when you are dealing with that, it will show you the output. In case you can run this code. Yeah. Now it's giving you the output. Okay, only one condition is falling over here, and we are checking the condition. That means if this person get 80%, this he is the topper of the class, or she is the topper of the class. We have only one condition. After getting the 80% by the student, the teacher say that this thing. So after this, not before this. So when it's dealing with that, when after condition two is if you have only one statement, you will use normal if statement. Let's come to the if and else statement, or true and false. Okay. So Keshav, can you write one quote over here? Yeah. So give it to that else. Okay. Why if we put the else outside the, we are not following the same line, because else part is a different part. Else part is a globally part, not that the normal part, which we not that the if else body. Okay. So over here, he will write that 15 is greater than 10. Okay. So now, what's the flowchart is doing? Kishi, can you open the word first? And then, yeah. So over here, as part. Over here, there's a two conditions. One condition is true and another condition is false. When it's come to false condition, it will directly jump to else. Okay, else didn't have any condition to check. So if the condition is true, then it will follow the if statement. Otherwise, directly it jumps towards the else statement. Like if you just say that if you got 80%, that means you are a topper. If you didn't get 80%, you are not a topper. You are a like failure, something like that. So the same condition, if he got more than 80 or 80, that time. That time, 80% that he was a topper. But if you get less of that, they will give you like failure. So there are two conditions. They are, both are dependent with each other. If one is true, then you will play the condition of that body, and another is false. That after the do not after checking the condition of if this is false, then it will print else part of the body. So both are doing the same thing, but they have certain conditions, like somewhere if you want to check that 80%, but in the 80% you want 85 above than 80% person in a first merit list, and below that 85 you and greater than 80 you want to print they are good but not the best. So for doing this type of things, you will use more condition statement, which we say that if, else, or ladder if else. So same thing, can you show the chart, Keshav, the PDF? Yeah. In this one, we are dealing with if else part. Okay, when, can you mark that when I'm telling this? Yeah, so in this one, when we are checking the condition, the expression, okay, when we are checking the condition, it will show you true and false statement. Okay, if the condition is true, it will show you the body of if and then print the statement. And if the condition is not true, it directly give you a false statement and also print the data. What's that mean? If you are right, then it also shows the data. If you are wrong, and at the same time also showing the data. But for the normal if, they only show the data when the condition is true. I think you guys got this if and if else. Guys, if you have any query, you can ask.
Actually, this things comes under this control structure, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, so we are dealing now with the structures.
Yeah, control structures, condition structures.
Yeah, okay, okay.
Okay, guys, you have any query with this if else conditions? Okay, I think I didn't get this new thing. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so let's jump towards the ladder if statement. Okay, what's the if normally? This is a normal graph. This is a normal graph for if else. Okay, over here when you have testing a condition, when the condition is true, they will show you the body of if and giving the statement. When condition is false, is also follow the body of as and then print some statement. And above of that, you are dealing with only. Okay, thank you. So, when you're dealing with the else part also, it's showing some data, different data. But in the above the example, if condition is giving you true data, but as having no condition, it directly gives you the output which according to you want after the hosting the data. Let's move up our question. Okay, nested if. When you have a condition and the condition is true, and again you want to check whether this condition is true again for this other statements or not, that time we see that nested if. Body of if having another body of if, but they have followed if the first condition of if body is true, like if the condition is true, then it's come and check the another body and then it will show you output. Can you move forward the flowchart issue? Yeah. Zoom it out, Kishu. So zoom in. Okay. So in the test case, there is two condition. Like first condition is go for true. When the condition is true, we divided the body again in true and false statement. Okay. So in the true and false statement, first time check with the if else condition, and again it's also checking the if else condition. And after that, it again check the if condition. Like let's take one example. We have 5 rupees. Okay, the 5 rupees, we are checking that whether this is an even number of a coin or not. And after that, we said if it is an even number, then it shows the prime factor or not. If they are showing the prime value or not. So that time you are checking the condition first with if condition give you true, then you will jump the condition of second. But if the condition is false, it directly gives you the statement. This condition is not true for even also. But if you have checked five is an even number, and then after that you printed that, if like print that this is an even, and now again check in the same body of that if the 5 number is prime or not. So in the, at the last of output, it will show you 5. You have a coin which having two properties. Even as well as prime, and if this is false, it directly come out and give it to data. Check out this, the body of as first point of view, it will directly give you the state that whole statement. That but if the condition is true, it go to the another conditions where the if and else part is doing their job. If it is true, it goes to the another checking conditions where true and false condition is there. And if it is true, it will show you output. And if it is false, it is also showing you output. So if you are false, that means the condition is going to give you the whole output. But if you are true, it will check again the another condition which is inside the body. Okay, another whole chart for the whole. Let's come to the point of view down there. Yeah, this is a really good example for the if, else, and else. Over here, when you start with the number, like for example, you have x is equal to 10, y is equal to 12. And we have checked the condition if x is smaller than y. Okay, last thing, when it's true, it comes to the true condition and it will print you x is less than y. Okay, and the rest of the code gonna same. And now, again, if it is false, then we provided that again one condition over which x is greater than. Okay, condition is true, then it will print you something. Its condition is false, it's checking one more statement whether this is x is greater than y or not. If this condition is true, it will jump to jump and give you the output. But if condition is false, it go for again one condition, one more condition, that's give you else part. Overall data, if first condition is false and second condition is false, it will directly jump to the else part. If first condition is true, it gives you output. But if first condition is false, it comes to the second condition and then check the value whether this is true or false. So this type of thing is coming under if, as if, and else. Okay, let me show you the examples. So this type of safe example we've done with deal with the code. Okay, so Keshav, can you do this type of examples in the proper code? But this, I think this code is for this is an example for the ladder effects.
What is the difference between a nested and an elif else actually?
Yeah, okay. So in nested if else, at the same time when you are dealing with nested if else, that means you are checking condition again and again, like if, else, and then if the condition is true or false. If condition is true, it directly converted into the another condition, like if one is equal is greater than two. And then you are checking that whether this this number is greater than other number or not. Then you print something. That means it just give you the if else nested type. Okay. And we say that again and again. You can provide that data in any conditions. Like if you are providing if and again you are providing the another body of that if and again you provide the again if and then provide the false of the same if for every if. But in NAS, in the ladder of one, it is defined that if you have one condition, if it is true, it will show you output. And if it is false, it jumps to the, your second conditions. Okay. But in a nested one, it checks the first and then jump to the second one. But in the first one, if it is true, then it comes to the second one. Otherwise, it will not follow that. But in this one, if as ladder, it will show you that in if condition is true, you will give the normal output. Okay, and if the condition is false, it again check the condition of second one, and then if that is true, that give you output. Otherwise, it again check the condition if you are provided. Have you got this?
Can you show it to the the flowchart, please? Can you just? Actually, if you see in this. First of all, we are getting an option like if x is less than y, there is two conditions like false and true, and in this we are getting an else if instead of elif over here. Why can't we go with an if condition again? What is going to be the difference if we go with instead of elif? If we go with the if condition again, it is going to be working as like a nested if, right? So both are same, isn't it? How does it differ?
Okay.
Rajesh, over here, as you can see in the flow chart, the if statement, when it comes to false, then only it will go to elif.
Okay.
Okay. But as you are asking that if we use two if statements instead of elif block, both the statements will be executed. Let's say, for example, if this is a student. Let me explain it with you. This with an example, okay? On the code.
Okay.
There is an if statement.
There is an if statement.
I is less than 10 is less than 15. Okay.
Yeah.
So when I use elif, and I say I is also less than 9. I is less than 12. Okay. So accordingly. Okay. What should be the output according to you?
Yeah, it is I is not less than 12, right? I mean, I is less than 12, isn't it? So,
yes.
Yeah.
And I is also less than 15.
Yeah.
So, what should be the answer according to you?
So both the things will give you the answer like 10 is less than 15 and another value 10 is less than 12.
This thing also, huh?
Yeah.
This statement, okay.
Less than 12.
What is the output?
10 is less than 15.
So if the first statement is executed, if it is true, then the second statement won't be checked, won't be even checked.
Okay.
Okay.
So if it is with the if condition,
Okay, see, both the schedule will be printed. See.
Okay.
Did you get the difference now?
I got it now. I got it. So if we use if condition, if yes. the condition is executed, it straight away goes
outside the whole if else block.
Yeah, it will go with the next if condition if it is nested if. But
it's
if
not,
it is,
this is a ladder. This is a ladder. This is not a nested if. For a nested, it to be nested if, it has to be like this. It has to be like this. It should be inside an if statement. This is a nested if.
Okay. Yeah, okay. That is what my difference is. I'm just checking for the difference between a nested if and an elif.
Okay. No, this is a nested if.
Okay.
Like
okay.
If an if block, if this if block is inside another if block.
Okay. Now, if you execute, how the output would be?
It will again print both the statements. Because first it is inside this. Because this one is true, this condition.
Mm-hmm.
Then it will print this. Right.
Okay.
Again, it will check for this.
Okay.
And then this is also true because 10 is less than 12.
Okay. So in that case, if it is elif, only if the if condition is fail, then it will come off to the elif
yeah.
condition.
You can also use elif inside this.
Okay.
Elif over here also.
I got it.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, let's come to another point of conditions. Yeah, this is a flow chart for else, if else, I think nested if else. Yeah, if else ladder, okay. So in this if else ladder, normally you are testing the condition. Khali, do you have any query? Questions?
No, I have no problem. Just okay, wrong place the hand raised. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah. So in this one, actually, Keshav has tell you that in nested if it will check the condition and then go to the if is it true then it will forward towards the another condition. But if it's false, it directly execute and give you the output, which is given to the else one. But if when it's come to the if ladder if else, it will check first condition. If it's true, it will give you a statement. But if false, it will check again any other conditions and then decide the same thing. And when it's turned towards the if else, it will check the first condition. And if the condition is true, then it will print the output. Otherwise, it jump to the direct else and give them. That is the main difference in the if else conditions. Okay. Keshav, jump to the another one. Yeah. Let's copy this one and tell the main give the output. Okay. So over here. Over is here is i is equal to 20. So we said over I is equal to 20, and then when you have like to take one example of the rupees, you have 20 rupees, and I is your 20 rupees, and you check that if 20 rupees is equal to 10 or not. Okay. This gives you false. So it directly jump to the another statement, not giving the statement. It directly comes to the condition, another condition. That is else if. Okay. Okay. We are right as if right over here. Okay. This is a statement you can change in another language. You will directly use else if. But in the Python, you can use elif. Okay. So I is equal to 50. Again, if check whether your 20 rupees is equal to 50 rupees or not. No, it's not true. Then it again jump to another condition. If 20 rupees equal 20, yeah, that's a true condition. It directly print the output and execute from the four conditions. You do not check another condition. It directly give the your. Let's run this code in the terminal. Okay, so in this terminal, what we actually have done that it will show you only last condition where the print I is wanting. Okay, Rajesh has said something and asked the question that I think they have some question in the mind, or other students also have some question in the mind. How we can deal with that, this thing? How we choose the if else condition, which if else condition or ladder if negative we will choose. So remember that when you are checking the again and again condition, you have two options. Whether you use the nested if, whether you use the else if else ladder, okay. Whether you use if else normally if else and normally if in the bottom of it, that you have three conditions, but maybe you have two conditions. Normal if nested if, and again normally you have if else. Okay. So when you are dealing with that, check out if you want to give the condition again after giving the condition false. Like let me check whether I'm checking that if students have 80%, those who are getting 80%, they are the topper of the class. Okay, so when you're checking with this condition, you will check what you will use. You normally use nested if, no, you didn't use nested if, okay? Because when you are dealing with that, that condition is only giving you the whole data and check the again. It will classify the whole data, like 70% student came, first condition is false, then it jumped to the second condition, and yeah, this condition is not true for the whole class. But if you jump to the if nested if, it will show, it will check first that 80% student, yeah, they have not get it 80%, it directly execute and give you the output that you didn't have any student of 80%. Okay. So let's remove this code and let we run this code for you guys, like for the 80%, and the 80%, yeah, Keshav can make it. Great point. Okay, so Keshav are taking that one student have a grade of 80. Okay, what it will do? It comes first in the condition of if, whether grade 80 is giving you like 80 is equal, is greater than equal to 8, grade is greater than equal to 80 or not. Yeah, this condition is true. It directly execute the print A. Okay, otherwise it will directly conclude the whole things with the else part. But if think about that, if the condition is false, if the grade value is smaller than 70, then it will jump towards the else if statement and then check whether this student is got more than 70 or not. Yeah, they are more than that 60, and it will print you the data, print the data as a B. You directly classify each and every student in a smaller way. Okay. So in this one, Keshav, do not take like directly 80, take input as an input from the user. Yeah. We are taking as an input from the user. Okay. So if you gather input from the user, you directly check whether the grade is belonging to 80% proper or not. So dealing with the same thing. Yeah. Keshav equal to also. You have entered wrong statement. In normal thing. In the so over here, Keshav gives the whole checking the whole conditions one by one, and then when he is running the code, it will take one input from the user and then check the whole condition. Like right now, Keshav run the code. Yep. So over here, he was asking the value. Yeah, you should put it out 55. Okay, it will show you the grid, C grid, how it's dealing with that. Yeah, the value is 55. It's come for the first condition where 55 is greater than not equal, not greater and not equal to than 80. This condition is false, then it comes to the another condition of else. As if, okay, over here also the condition is false. 55 is not greater than and small and equal to 60, it will also give me false, and then again it will jump to the next condition. So in if else, as if the later conditions, the condition is false, at the same time the code will be checked under the condition. If the condition is true, it directly executed it and printed the data. Right now its condition is true, it didn't check the another part, it directly print the data, print C. The whole check of the condition is gonna false, because cancel out, because the one data is gonna true over here. It is a front again the code. Again the code. Okay, right now Keshav, input minus 10. This giving me invalid entry. Okay, so why A was giving the invalid entry? Because the whole condition above the S part is not valid. They all are false. So the last condition is that it will printing you that the invalid entry. I think all of you got the whole point. Where you use the else part, or where you use the if statement, where you use the latter statements. If you guys have any query with regard to the condition statement, then you can ask. Because we will run towards the loop statements. Okay, short if statement, I already told. That's a normal condition of if. Shorthand is. Shorthand of if else statement also like if and else. That's a normal part. Let me write this. Okay. Shorthand basically means that when you are trying to do the conditions with if else, you have only a single if and single else. That's having a normal thing. And when you are giving the statement as output, you can put it out like this also. You didn't want to give the body for that. You directly give this type of condition, you directly accept the body. But if you didn't do like this, you will give the proper space for that whole statement. Otherwise, it will show you error. Okay, so that's come the loop part. I think we have done with the whole things. We should care a couple of PPT first. We have deal with, yeah, we have done with this also. This also, yeah, loop part. Okay, so Kishan, can you continue with this conditions?
Yeah, so guys, now let's go to for loop. What are loops? So loops allows us to execute the statement block for multiple times. Let's say I want a statement to be executed more than one time. Let's say I want to print 10 numbers. So for writing, for printing, yeah,
sorry for disturbance, but can we ask what about what the student got about the normal English? What is the meaning of
loop? Right, correct. So, guys, what does loop mean? You might have come across the term loop various times. So, can anyone explain what does loop mean?
I think it is something, it executes the program until a condition has been satisfied.
Correct. Anybody else?
That's a little bit close, but not a correct one.
Khalil, you want to add?
Yeah. Actually, the first one is right. The loop is the command which it is executed until the its condition fulfilled. Okay. just like clean command is until repeat and repeat until this end command is finished. Is it?
Close? Yeah, yeah. Kya Khalil, you are close. You are close.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else would like to tell? Please, you can also comment in the chat window. Raj, Sarthak, Bhargavi, anybody else? Loop is used to repeat some set of statements. Okay.
Sorry, can I say something?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
I think it's for calculation. Because it's like for us, for example, it's really annoying when you have to calculate everything the same. So you just make one time, when the computer read that, this is you write that one time, and then that's why they can loop. This is the meaning of loop. This means repeating, but in the system, of course, it's calculated, is it?
Yeah, that's very close, but not the correct one. Okay, so let me tell you that what is the loop, and then Keshav, we will move forward. So basically, guys, all of you that say that there is some when you're trying to do one thing again and again, and Rajesh said that when the condition is one of course, yeah, that's a loop. But I will end up a normal word. It will follow the sequence when the sequence gonna in a wrong way or somewhere, that time the thing is gonna stop. I mean, what is the sequence? It follows sequence and the pattern. Okay, so loop is that it is a condition which come across again and again and follow the pattern which you have provided to that particular state. Bishop, is it correct? If you want to add something, can.
No, it's sufficient.
Yeah, move forward.
So, I hope everybody understood what loops are. It allows us to execute the statement or some block for multiple times. Okay, as many times you want. So, most of the time, let's say I want to print a number from 1 to 10. I will go around like printing. And I will print 2. And again, I have to print. So it becomes hard for me to print like 5 statements. Now let's say I want to print 100 lines or 100 numbers. So I will have to again print like this. So what should be the alternative to this? There have to be some alternative, else we have to repeat the same steps again and again. So for these, we are introduced with a concept called loops. So in Python, there are 2 kinds of loops. One is while loop, the other is for loop. Okay, so over here, this is the flow chart. So over here, we check the condition. The condition is true. Then the conditional code is executed. And then again, the condition is checked. And then if the condition is false, the loop is terminated or the program is ended. So this is a sample flow chart. Okay, now over here, let's search for. Okay, see here. The for loop is used to iterate over a sequence, list, tuple, string, or other iterable objects. Iterating over a sequence is called traversal. So now let's straight away move to first for loop. Okay, so I will zoom in. This is a flow chart. So for each item in sequence, last item is checked. If it is true, then last item reached. So if the last item is not reached, then we go inside the body of for, and then whatever statement is there, we execute it. and then again we check if the last item has reached. So when the last item has reached, it will exit from the loop. Let's understand this with an example. So this is a list, right? Now I want to traverse through this list. So what I will do is for number in numbers. Okay, the numbers over here is this, and we are storing this particular each value in the number, in the variable number, and say, let's say print number. Okay, now I will execute this particular statement. See what it returns me is the each number 6, 5, 3, 8, 4, 2, 5, 4, 11. So what does it do? It helps me in traversing through this particular list. Okay, for number in numbers, meaning yesterday Amit taught you about the membership operators. This in is that particular membership operator. So the number over here is a member of this particular variable numbers. So for number in numbers returns me the member of the variable numbers. Okay, same goes if I pass on a string. Let's say I passed on Python, okay, as my string, and then let's execute. See, it returned me each character P-Y-T-H-O-N in different lines. I hope this concept is clear to you. This particular for loop is clear. Can anybody answer if it is clear to you?
Can you please show me the syntax of this?
Syntax is this only, like the for loop. Okay, the for keyword. Rajesh, are you watching?
Yeah, I'm with you.
The for is the keyword. Okay, it is used to define that we are going to execute a for loop.
Okay.
Then the number has to be whatever value you have to store in the particular variable. Let's say number, I want to store P, okay, inside this number. So the number has to be a different variable, not the same variable as this.
Okay. But usually the for statements or for condition in the C or C, any other language, there will be one condition and increment, something like that, isn't it?
Yes.
But in this, it is totally different.
Right now, we are traversing through a list. There is another condition. There is a conditional for loop also, which I will explain to you after this particular example.
Okay. But this is a very basic one, like for with the variable name in. The in is something static one, or we can even change it actually.
No, in is static. See, it is coming in orange, na?
Yeah, it is a
keyword. It is a keyword. Yesterday, remember Amit taught you.
Yeah. We have been. It is something like an identity or
membership. Membership.
Yeah, membership operator.
Yeah.
So with a similar type of membership operator, we can use not in as well, and we can also go with the identity.
Yeah, we can also. That's it for not in. This will also do. But we generally don't use, because if we have to traverse through a list, if we do the not in function, then how will we traverse through that particular list?
Yeah, I got you. No, I'm just asking you where we can even use that type of operators as well.
Correct. We can use.
Okay.
Is
it only with the membership identity, or even we can go with arithmetic or relational as well?
No, we can only use in.
Okay.
Because when you use for traversing, you will have to use membership, na? Because over here, P-Y-T-H-O-N is a member of the numbers variable.
Okay.
So when you have to iterate through this, we have to use the in operator.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yeah. Thank you.
Now, I will explain the conditional. What you asked me, na? I will explain the conditional. For loop. So for I in range 1, 10, print I. Okay. So the range function over here will provide me with a list from ranging from 1 to 10, not even 10, less than 10. The number which is parsed over here, less than 10. So I will execute this particular statement. See, 1, 2, 3, 4 till 9. The last number, that is 10, is not printed. To print a number, to print the last number, that is 10, you have to add one number to the this part. If we do this 11, then only we will get the output as 10. Rajesh, now is it clear?
Yeah, I got it now. So you are now having a condition there.
Yeah, this is a range. This is not even a condition. It is exactly the same as above. Okay. But yeah. Instead of having a list that is numbers. Numbers is a list, right? Let me give you over here as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. For example, I have 5 elements. Okay. Mm-hmm. And instead of numbers, I have given a range function. Okay. This will return me with exactly this particular thing.
No, I didn't understand it.
I'm saying, let's over here, we pass the numbers.
For number, range is something like you are defining it to give the numbers between 1 to 5, isn't it?
Yeah.
But what does it happens with the numbers? The number is a completely different variable which is being declared above.
Yeah, that is a list. Numbers is a list. This one is a list.
But there is nothing related with this.
No, it is not related.
That's what I'm asking.
I was trying to explain that. What this range function will do is exactly this.
Okay, it will just display from 1 to 5.
Yeah.
So the range is a keyword, isn't it?
Yeah, range is a keyword.
Ah, okay.
It is not a keyword, it is a function's name.
Ah, okay. So a range can be used something like a starting point, a starting variable to a ending variable.
Ending variable.
Like
yes.
Okay. And it can take only the integers, isn't it?
No, that's not the case.
Okay.
You should show an example with the length.
What?
Give one like over there is a number. No, number is a list. Count the length and then provide that variable over here.
Achcha.
I think so. In future, might be with some other program, we will get into it. Actually, we can go forward.
We are already done, so see.
Okay, yeah.
We gave the length of the number. It is 5. Correct?
Got it.
I said that the last number will not be printed because it checks for 1 less than the last number.
Yeah. If we make it like a plus 1 there, then we will get the 5 there, right?
Yes. See, we get the 5.
Yeah, got it.
I hope the for loop is clear to everybody.
Thank you.
Another thing also, the increment decrement operator.
Yes. I was going to tell that only. Now, over here, we can see that it is increasing by 1 only, okay? That we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 over here. That is, we are only incrementing by 1. If you want that, I want this increment to be like more than, let's say I want to be increasing the each number by 2. Okay. And let me give it the length till 10. So I will make another argument passing to this variable. This is to this function by giving comma and then the particular number. And then I will execute. See, it is starting from 1 and returning each and every number after 2, that is incrementing by 2. So 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 2 is 5, 5 plus 2 is 7, 7 plus 2 is 9. Is this clear? Like how we will increment? We can customly increment. We can also add 5. So it will give me just 1 and 6.
Yeah, Raj, you can. Keshav, you can write the syntax right now.
What?
Normal syntax for variable in range.
Starting point and then. For variable in range start, comma end, comma custom increment. This is a syntax with a colon. And whatever body you want to execute, you will execute over here.
Yeah, one more thing, guys. When we are dealing with the for loop and other loops in the another languages, like C, C++, and Java, that's a different, because they are dealing with the number. They increase their value and they increase their whole thing. But in over here, you are basically dealing with the true and false condition. Okay? So they're not dependent with the number value. You can might be change the whole thing. And later on, I will show you how why I'm telling this, showing that true and false condition. Because when it comes to while loop, the condition is printed when the whole statement is true. Otherwise, you didn't. But there is no increment and decrement chance. Notification.
So this is the for loop. And this is the syntax which we were talking about. So it is a conditional iterative statement used to execute the block for a specified number of times. We are providing the range that it has to be executed 10 times. So it is executing for particularly 10 times. Okay. So the for loop is used when we need something to be specific. Okay. This is the example. Now let's move to nested for loops. Okay, so everybody understood what is a nested if statement, right? Can anyone comment? Yeah, so everybody, I hope everybody understood what is a nested if. So exactly the same is a nested loop. Okay, a loop inside a loop is a nested loop. So let me show you an example. I want a list. I want to print this particular pattern, like 1, 1, 1, 1, and 2, 2, 2, 2, 3, 3, 3, 3, 4, 4, 4, 4, 5, 5, 5, 5. Okay, so I want to print this. I want this particular statement to be print, this to be the output. Okay, so we can do this using a for statement. So for I in range 1 comma 6. Okay, over here 6, instead of 6, it should be 5, because I want 5 statements, right? So I have to increment it by 1. So this particular for loop will provide me with the number of rows. Okay, so it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Correct? Now I will go for J in range, comma 6. Now this particular statement will give me number of columns. That is how many times 1 is printed, how many times 2 is printed. That is 5 times. Is everybody following me?
Yeah. Hello. Yes. We are watching. Hello.
Are you understanding?
Yeah. I'm still following in.
So always, if in case if you need 5 times to be executed, so the ending point should be mentioned as 6. It should be one increment always, so that it ends before the first number.
Yeah. There is another way of representing this, that if you want to something to be executed like for a certain amount of time, you should start the range from 0 till that number. Okay, it will print the same thing, but the number will be different. Let's say you want particularly 5 statements who are not using this value, who are not using I. Okay, so you can use like 0 to 5 also. That will also give you 5 particular outputs. But I value will be different. It will be executed till 4, but it will be executed 5 times. See, the value is from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, but it is 5. If I say print and now hello, then it will print 5 times. Rajesh, did you understand?
Yeah, man. Yeah. I got
you. You can do this also.
Yeah, if you start with 0, it starts with 0 actually. So the count, the total number of count is going to be the same. If you start with 0 to 5, it is going to be like 0 to 5. If it is going to be 1 to 5, then it is going to be 1 to 4 then.
Yes.
Yeah, I got it.
So now, now we were talking about nested for loop. Okay, so we need to print this pattern. Can anybody understand what the pattern is? This is the pattern. Can anybody unmute and tell what does this pattern mean? Is there anybody who can understand this pattern?
No, I'm not.
Like, how will you print this particular pattern? Anybody? I think somebody messaged consecutive. Can you explain a little bit more, Sarthak? Okay, since nobody is answering, then I will have no gap. No, it's not that, Sarthak. Okay, let me explain. Over here, this line, in this particular row, you will see that what is the number that is displayed in this particular row. That is 1. Okay. And what line is this? It is first line of the program, of the output. Now, what is the second line? It is displaying the second line. Okay. Similarly, it is displaying the third line. And this is displaying the fourth line. And this is displaying the fifth line, correct? Now, when I have to print, okay, how will I print? And see, the value is also the same. And each of these 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 are printing for into 5 times. Everything is printed 5 times, na? So how we will
By using for loop, right?
Yeah,
nested for loop, right?
Yeah, we will be using a nested for loop. For I in range from 1 to 6. And for J in range from again 1 to 6. Okay, so this for loop will give me the number of lines, that is 5. Okay. And this will give me number of number of each character, like how many characters are there. Okay, so that will be said as number of each character in one line. Okay, now I will say print I, because whatever the number line is, like if it is the first line, then we are printing that particular line, correct? So it will be I, comma, ends with and then print. Okay. So first, let me show you the what will be the output of this, and then we will none attribute ends with. I think it will just ends.
Hey, you can use it slash and also.
No, no, I want to print in the same line, not in a different line.
Okay, you want to print in the same line?
Yeah. Okay, got it.
So, yeah, come outside of the body. After the body. Can you use it?
I think it will work.
It will work.
It is. See, it gave me the same output. That is 111, 222, 333, 444, 555. Guys, are you following? Like, did anyone understand what we did over here?
I think it, what is this end statement is?
Which statement?
Yeah, what is it? End, actually?
End, okay. So if I do not use this end statement, let me show you the output. I think you will understand. See, each time it will print in a different line. What does this print command do? It prints in a different line. Whenever this print command is called, it will always print in a new line. Okay. So in the sequence, see 111 is like present in the same line, correct? So the end statement, what it will do is print this particular 1111 in the same line. Okay.
So you can do something more.
Can you take what is this last print colon is for?
This is you can also remove the colon. We can't remove the colon. Okay. This line is for a new line.
Ah, okay. After the first 1111, this is going to be executed for the second line.
Yeah. So a new line is, the command goes to a new line, and then we can print another line.
Okay. So if it is like a single quote, it is something intimating for a new line.
Blank. Yeah. No. No. It is blank.
Ah. Okay.
It is. See now, if I do a backspace, it will remove the quote.
Okay.
Did you understand like what the concept of a for loop is? And did you understand how did we make this pattern?
If you cannot run it, please, you know.
Huh?
Run it, just execute it. Execute, yes. Let's see. Is there any gap between the lines, okay? 1111 and after that, in blank line, 2222. Is it, how can it be in the pattern?
You are getting this thing?
Not this thing, actually. Just 5-1. After that, blank line, then say 2-2-2, 5-2-5-2, then blank, then 3-3-3, then blank, like this. Just one after or line, just a blank line, okay?
So you're getting a blank line after
one, yes.
Like simply, we have to take off the sprint space, isn't it? The last line. If you take it off, then I think so his question will be answered. If you take off this, he needs the 1-1-1. After that, there must be a space. Blank. After that, in the same line, 2-2-2. In the same line, after that, 333 has to be.
Yes, like this.
No, he wants all the whole output.
It's not normal pattern. No. Normal pattern is 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, like that.
Now, can you execute this? How this output will be?
See.
Yeah, this is what he is asking, but there must be space between after 1 and 2, there must be one space in between 1 and 2. After that, there must be a space between 2 and 3.
Not space, actually, new line. I want a new line. Okay.
One, after that, 2 to 2, then new line, blank line, okay, one blank line, just like an interpreter, okay, one interface, like M0 or X again, yeah, that, like this, maybe, guys, yes, this one, thank you, yeah, that's one, just add this one, yeah, oh, I see, yes, I am, this one, yes, thank you. I hope the pattern is clear to you and how to make a pattern using for nested for loops. Does anybody has doubt?
Yeah, hi Keshav. I have a small doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah, what is this J is there now? Why we mention that J?
See, I had to use a variable. Okay, for storing
it can be anything. Yes, yes. This is big string, big variable.
It is just a variable name.
Yeah, variable.
Okay, there we can insert any kind of alphabet.
Yeah, you can use any alphabet, but if that alphabet is a keyword, it should not be a keyword.
Yeah, should not be keyword. And it must be, is there an alphanumeric word? Can it be alphanumeric?
No.
Only string, right?
This thing.
No, alphanumeric, just A1.
This can be.
This can be happy, right?
Okay. Yeah, it can be.
Yeah, okay.
Guys, if you have any doubt, then please ask right now.
Keshav, can you explain again? Okay. Hey, Jagati, I will explain you after the class. You can ask this thing. Keshav, can you proceed forward with this?
Yeah, let's move forward. I hope everybody understood what a conditional and a nested condition for statement is. So, okay, now I already have explained what a loop statement is. Now let's go for while. Sure.
No, break and continue pass. You can explain the trade functions.
Yeah, let's do this. Okay, so what I will remove this and just keep this. So there are three major keywords: break, continue, and what was the other one? Pass. Okay, these are the three particular.
Keshav, wait a minute. Let me let we ask them that what do they mean by break, continue, pass.
Guys, can you anyone like tell by the definition of these three words what do they mean?
Guys, actually a language is not like too much hard, like Java is also easy, every language is easy. They have a particular word which you know about the meaning and you can proceed with that. Main thing in coding is that of practice.
These are just some English words: continue, break, pass. You come across these three words every day.
Guys,
is it something like if it is break on a continuous loop or loop something? If you give this option as break, it will come jump out of the loop.
Right. And what do you think continue mean?
Pretty sure.
Data, please show three examples. I think. Sorry.
Pass, jump on, separation. Okay. Sadhak answering that is break for the separation, pass for jump on. And what about the continue? Continue used to skip code in the loop, yeah, but that's good. That's good. I think continuous, right, Raj is here with that.
Raj is continuous. Right about continuous keyword. And anybody for pass? Because Sarthak, it's not jump on.
Jump on for the break, I think. So,
yeah.
Pass. Okay, normally what do you mean pass?
Something like skipping?
Skipping, but not like that.
No, the definition is not that.
Like if I say that, Keshav, can you contribute that? I have passed with that whole thing with Keshav. Avoiding getting an error. That for the try and catch
after that this one.
And that's try and accept block.
Yeah. Yeah, you are all of a little close with that, like placeholder.
No.
At all. Okay, I pass to Sartha. Okay, normally, let me explain, Keshav.
Yeah, good.
Okay. So, for the break statement, that means you are dealing with you're stopping somewhere, okay, when you want to terminate something. Like if you want to run 10 steps, but you have 20 steps, and after 10 steps, you want to stop something. So at the same time, you will use the break statement. Terminate this loop without running the whole times, okay? And what about the continue? When you are continuing with that, for the current thing, you will jump that from there and come again to the whole condition. It doesn't mean you are jumping with the whole loop, but you are jump for this the condition which is below you, okay? Below for that. Like for example, if Keshav said that let we continue with this one, okay? So we will jump. If I have some another topic to explain to you. So at the same time, I will stop for this topic and directly jump towards the part which Keshav has said. Okay, the normal thing, a pass. Pass means when you have passed something, some data, when you put some data, but you didn't have. When someone asks you some question and you didn't have an answer, that's either a pass. So like that, if you have checked the condition, but you didn't have any data to explain or to display something, you directly say the pass. That pass will help you. Keshav, did you want to add something?
No, Amit.
Okay. I think everyone got this one. Continue, break and pass. Let's explain with the little bit code example.
Okay, so let's say for I in range from 1 to 10. Okay. And let's say I will explain what a break statement does. If I is equal to 5, okay, then I will break. And then before that, I will print I. So this particular block is inside the for loop, and only the break statement is inside. Only the break statement is inside the if block. Okay. Now, when I execute it, see, only numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 was printed. So what did break do over here is, it encountered that I is equal to 5, it break. That is, it brought me over here. That is out of the loop. Okay, it brought me out of the loop. So no other statements will be printed after we encounter the break statement. Correct? Is anybody having any doubts regarding what a break statement is?
No,
clear.
Thank you.
Okay. So now let's remove this break statement and then insert continue. Okay. So what will continue do is when we encountered this particular condition, when it is true, then continue will be printed. What will continue do is continue will transfer the command back to the for statement. It will be print how does Python execute is line by line, correct? First this will be executed, then this, and then the print statement will be executed. But instead of this, what it will do is it will transfer back the control to the for loop. So this statement will be neglected. This statement will be neglected. Okay, I think you will understand this with an example. let's run. Okay, so you can see that over here 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 is not printed, but 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 is printed. In the break, what it was happening, it was just printing 1, 2, 3, 4, and after 5 it disappeared. But over here we got the whole data, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, but 5 was not printed, because 5 was the control was given back to the for loop when 5 was encountered. Does anybody have doubt like what continue does?
It is something like skipping that particular condition.
Correct. It is skipping that whatever is after that. If this condition comes to true, this condition, then the continue statement is executed. And then when the continue statement is executed, what does this continue do? Is it transfers the control back to the for loop. Okay. And so whatever statements are below that will not be executed.
This continue and other things can be, I mean, unconditional statements can be used only under if condition or?
No, you can also use, but then what will be the advantage of using continue?
Okay.
Like, let's say if I do this, okay. And
so after, there is no range of loops, right? Yeah. I got it. No.
After that, I do just break. What do you think will it print?
Nothing.
It will print one, because print is above, na? It will only print one. Got it?
Yeah.
So okay. That's why basically, you know, generally we use it inside if blocks, so that it is easy to use, na? Like it is logical to use inside if blocks.
And only on a looping statements, which is feasible to use as it runs within the looping type of things.
Uh-huh. Correct. I think somebody texted.
No, he was actually.
Achha, okay. I think everybody is now familiar with break, continue. So now let's go with
pass.
Okay. So let's execute pass.
You should remove the print statement and if condition is.
This?
Yeah. And then run the code.
It will give an error.
Okay, because we are using right now for loop, and they didn't have any data to print or to display you, so it will show you error. But if someone pass right over the pass, at the same time it will didn't give error because they have passed the data. They already said that we have no data to display or something.
Everybody got what does pass do?
No, it's not clear.
Okay, so let me explain again using that last example we used.
Please.
Yeah. So this was the example. When we run this particular command using the pass keyword, okay, what it is done, it printed 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It printed the whole thing. It didn't like remove any particular number or anything. It didn't remove 5. It did not like through the loop outside, through the control over here. Okay, so pass statement is just like another statement, but it is used where you don't want, like, let's say over here I cannot decide what I have to do with this if block. Okay, I got the input I equal to 5, but I don't know what to do inside it. So I use the keyword pass so that I don't get an error, as Amit recently showed, na, like we remove the whole thing and then just run the program, it gave an error, an EOF without parsing error. Am I right? My EOF. So what did that error mean is nothing was passed inside the loop body. So sometimes when you cannot decide like what to do with that particular for loop with that particular function of with that particular if block, we can use the keyword pass so that the Python interpreter does not throw an error. Rajesh, now is it clear?
Typically, I have to just go through it again, actually.
Wait a minute, let me say that. Actually, if I am asking you something, some question. Okay, Rajesh, like I am asking that, did you know about for loop? You tell me something.
Yeah.
So at the same time, if you have no data, what you will tell me? You directly say that I didn't know, or you directly say pass.
Exactly.
The same thing is going over here. When you run a for loop, if you have no body, if you have no data to print or display, or if you have no action after that, so you directly say pass, I have no data, and it will not give me any error. But if you are, like, for example, let's say give another example, if you didn't know about that, what is for loop, and you are telling me a wrong thing.
Okay.
That time I say that this is error, this is a wrong thing.
Okay.
If you didn't know about that, you just said pass. So after that, I will tell you, or I will tell you later on.
So even if it is going to trigger out some error message, if you have a keyword of pass, it will execute it.
No, it not didn't give you the, if you use the pass, it will show you that this condition is right now we have holding this condition. We have no data to do with this same condition. But yeah,
if you,
this is,
If the condition is if I is not equal to 5, if you make out that condition is something false condition, can you just make it out like something different, like 12 or something? What happens now?
We give the same output.
Same output.
Because this condition will never be true. And if this condition is never true, then pass will not be executed.
Actually, you are giving a data in the for loop. You are giving the data of print I, okay?
Yeah.
In the body, you have if condition as well as print condition. And the same time when you are checking the data, you are giving the pass in the if condition. When the if condition is true, then the pass condition is gonna pass on. But right now, its condition is not giving you any data. Because 12, I didn't have any value of 12. So they directly print the data. If they have no data, like for example, Keshav, can you remove print I? Okay, and I is equal to 3. So you have passed the and remove the pass.
Remove.
Yeah, remove the pass. Right over here we have for loop. Okay, Rajesh.
Yeah.
And in the body of for loop, we have some data. We have checking the data. So
yeah.
For loop having some data, but if it didn't have any data after condition gonna true. So it will show you error because they did not know about the data. But will be proceeding forward. It will show you error.
There is no condition. No, nothing to be executed after if condition.
Yeah. So to manage this thing, if you given the pass keyword, the machine will get the data that we will hold this one. We do not run this. It will run the condition for for loop, but didn't run if condition.
And there will be no output as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So if there is any logical error.
Yeah.
So it will bypass it.
Yeah. If this is a logical error, if I is equal to 3. So at the same time, if you pass this data, directly it will not show you any error and not showing any output.
Okay. Actually, it should execute some data on if condition, but there is nothing to execute there.
Yeah.
So still just escape the loop, then we give the keyword as pass.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I got it now. So if you don't have any condition to execute or anything to process within the if condition, then you can use the pass.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, I got it.
Startup, but if we print I without pass, then also result will be the same. Okay. Actually, Startup, you are dealing with the print statement. That print statements come under body of for loop, not the if else if body. Okay. If the body is coming under the
that not running in the body of for loop, at that same time it will show you error. So when you open
the code, add a print command there, print command and two print command. One is the yes, and another is for the error message. The next one.
Okay.
This thing, no?
Yeah. Wait a minute. If it's true, then print I scroll be print. Okay. If the false, then the error message will be happy. Show. Okay. The error message print also how it, we add.
Okay, in the whole,
false.
Yeah, Kyle. In the whole code, okay, there's a for I is in range, okay, the
yes,
for loop having a their body in which we have proceeded with if and print. The print and if condition are coming under body of for loop. Okay,
yeah.
So for loop have a body, they have some statement, they have some value to print or to display, they have some condition. Okay, but when it's come to if condition, when the value of I is 3 in the whole loop body, and you didn't pass some data and you didn't pass pass also, that time it will show you error. Okay, so we directly pass the thing. So when if I equal to is coming over there, it didn't do anything. It directly print the value. That condition of if condition is like stop hold at the holding position. They didn't follow anything.
If the from the line 3 pass say send the line 4, then what will be happen? So of the pass and the print I passes the last one, yes. No, pass.
Remove the pass.
Remove the pass, yes. Yes, there is
the remove the pass.
Yes, this one, yes.
Okay.
What will happen?
It will only print you 3.
So why not between the six or the
other? I'm telling you.
Yes.
So when you are coming in the for loop, when I is 1, it come in the condition of if I equal to 3.
Yeah.
Okay. So this condition is false. It didn't go to the body of if. Okay. But right now it is they are in the body of for, and the for condition they have didn't pass. That means you are holding. Hold on. We didn't have any data to print out, or we didn't have any condition to display something. Okay.
One repeat. Okay. Nothing else.
Okay. If you are passing the pass in the body of for loop. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That means the whole condition gonna that pause in the whole holding code. Okay. But in the body, we have pass if condition, if I equal to 3.
Yes.
When this condition is true, it will give you the output 3.
Yes.
Okay. But the other conditions, the for loop say that we have in my body, we have provide pass. That means the whole data, if we have.
Finished.
But yeah.
In,
stop
right?
it. Yeah. Oh, stop over there. Yeah. Hold on.
No room. Look there. Okay.
Yeah.
No, recheck the I into 6.
Yeah.
No,
actually they will run again, but they didn't display anything.
Oh, I see. But why didn't it display again?
What?
Only for the pass command they didn't display
why we are using pass command or we
yes, run it.
See Khalil,
yes,
I understand please. What your question is. You are asking like why is not 1, 2, 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 are not printing, right?
Not this. No. 3, 6, 9, like this. Okay.
No. We are checking that if I is equal to 3. We are not checking for multiples of 3.
We are checking only
for 3. Yeah, only
one.
Number.
Only 3. Okay. Oh,
that's
three.
Why. That's why it's three. Printing only 3.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Yes, that's all.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Rajesh, for explaining over there.
Yes.
I hope I was right now, right?
Yeah.
And do we have a session tomorrow, as it is a weekend?
Saturday.
Yeah.
We have, but in Sunday we have already.
We too have it on Sunday too?
Every day.
No, sir. Sunday is holiday.
Sunday is closed?
Or yeah, we can do one thing. We will take tomorrow. We will take a doubting session. If anyone has any doubt, they can join and they directly ask anything.
So tomorrow it will be a double session?
No, not at all. It's single. If you want that session, then we will proceed for the session. If you want for the doubting session, we will continue with that also.
We can confirm with the rest of the people as well, since it's not only me. No?
Yeah, guys, can you tell us right now?
Like tomorrow you want a doubt session or a lecture type session like today?
But are we on the track actually?
Yeah.
Are we on the right track? Actually, we didn't skip the track. Now we are not logging back, isn't it?
No.
Okay. I think so. We have to make out some more workouts so that we can make out some simple programs and such type of things.
Yeah, that's why I'm telling that if you want to try this Saturday time, if you want to try a doubting session or something, you want to innovate with some new code and stuff, you can.
Actually, we can have the session on tomorrow if it is okay for everyone, so that you can give out something, assign something, so that we can try to solve it out, and we can just you can just make out some basic programs with some errors, so we can try to sort it out what is the error in it, so that we can identify neither we are into the right thing. So next we can just create our own simple write of programs, and we can just develop something like that if it is okay.
We were talking about that only.
Tomorrow morning I will provide you some questions and error finding questions, and after that we will discuss in the evening time.
Cool. Sorry, I'm giving too much of options to you.
No, it's not to be.
That's really a good thing because you and some people are giving the good response over there, and in the group we have find 200 something people, but only a few of you are there. That's really cool for us because you.
Only 17 nations, right? Actually, unfortunately, I didn't install my program. I tried, but I can't.
Actually, you when I'm accessing your that time my keyboard is not working in your laptop. Only mouse is working. So I will provide
you, if you tell me, I can assist you. Okay.
My Keshav, can you explain him? Khalid, you have lagging of that, address path, the environment variable. So I have provided one video link. Now over there, we have provided how you can deal with the environment part and how you set the environment.
I installed the VB code, but I can't do the Python. Okay.
Because you have displaying the Python.
Yes. I can't install this Python yet.
Yeah, you can give that code again, and Keshav, you can access.
Yeah.
Can you really assist me? Now or the next time?
Tomorrow for the routing time point of view, I will explain you. We share your screen and we will fix it out.
Tomorrow 6:30.
Yeah, we will tell you tomorrow. In morning we will assign you questions now. That time only we will tell about the doubt session.
Okay,
Khalid, you can use if the Python is not installing you right now. For the questions, you can use Colab. Okay, I have actually already told in this previous session. Colab is a good thing where you will get the whole platform and the Python symbols. Okay,
I will share you the link right now.
Can you share me the link, please? Thank you.
Just create a new notebook.
Yes.
And then click on code, and whatever code you want to run. Write on it. Okay. And over here will be a connect button. Okay. First connect it. Let it connect. See, it is connected, right?
Yes.
And then it will come like this. And then whatever you write now, print.
Hello. Yes.
And then after writing your code, just click on this play button. And whatever is the output will be displayed.
So I can do my work.
Okay, yeah, you can do your work here. Yes, yes.
Oh, yes. So this is what I'm doing. What is the name of the site?
Yeah.
Did you send me the site name?
We have already sent it.
Oh, thank you. Check I'm checking it now. Thank you.
Guys, can you give the feedback so we will improve more?
So that's all for today?
Yeah.
Khalid.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, both of you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Khalid.
I'm from Bangladesh, you know? Hello?
Yeah.
I think you are also Kolkata, right? Someone maybe I don't know the Bengali language. Is there anyone from Kolkata or Bengali?
Yeah, I am from Kolkata.
Oh, I see. That's why I'm here. Sometimes you use the Bengali language. No, just okay. Thank you. So I'm from Bangladesh. Okay. I visited 3 times in Kolkata. Okay, earlier. I will take you later. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Keshav.
Okay.
Bye, everybody. Thank you. Bye.
Guys, can you give us feedback if you want to improve something?
Yeah. Do you think like we are having some problems understanding or any particular issue?
Oh, thank you. You're so like what I say. You're so kind. Thank you, both of you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Okay. Bye.
Guys, I think Keshav can understand this one.
Just now, as Rajesh said, we will practice tomorrow. And as Amit told you, na, because you will send me some kind of notes, so then the people will be resolved the issues. What is the subjective knowledge, they'll get it. That's what we'll do tomorrow itself. Evening section, we have if kind of any doubts and everything, we'll discuss it and we'll close that. That is a better way, this thing.
Yeah, that's
the whole the week and till from the 3 to 4 classes, what all the subjects is there, just give us a assignment of things. So then we will implement it and build so that everybody knows that where they will stand, what kind of errors and what kind of issues will become, they will issue us.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other feedback?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Raj.
Thank you. What about Sarthak?
Sarthak, Nandera, Topister Nandera, Ajit. Anybody?
Okay, let's end up this.
Hello? Yeah, hello?
Yeah,
I didn't find the code, okay? What you see. And find that code, okay? For temporary work. Did you send me the code? Link, URL link?
I send in the chat. You can see.
I'm searching. Can you?
Yeah.
Can you send your last number?
See.
72. 72.
Actually, he was searching in the WhatsApp chat.
No, I was seeing. I sent it in Google, like in the call chat.
Why is this? So sorry, I'm
Google Meet chat. Google Meet chat.
Oh, I see. I'm searching the WhatsApp.
Okay. Yeah.
So, no.
Okay, I'm searching. Thank you.
Okay. Guys, for that whole note for the Python, you will click over here to see the whole view in the paradox site.